court, counsel, my name is Bart Larson. I represent the defendants and the appellants in these three matters. The first matter, the D.M.S.I. matter, presents primarily a question of standing. In fact, that's a common issue throughout the three cases that are being argued today, specifically whether or not Branch Banking and Trust Company had the right to enforce the loan documents at issue when it filed these lawsuits in 2011. Now, the history of this case goes back to 2003-2004, when the defendants initiated a banking relationship with Colonial Bank. Defendants are real estate developers. At one point in time, there were over a dozen loans made by Colonial Bank to this group of defendants that were, with combined principal balances of well in excess of $20 million. Most of these loans were secured by real estate, primarily raw land, either in Nevada or Arizona. Some were used as construction loans. Others were secured by operating businesses. The loan at issue in the D.M.S.I. case was unique in that it was unsecured. It was an unsecured line of credit. Now, as Southern Nevada, Arizona entered the recession in 2008-2009, most of these loans had come due and been extended or renegotiated. The defendants and Colonial Bank were working to salvage what they could from these loans and the assets that served as collateral. 2009, however, the pressure came too much to bear for Colonial Bank. The FDIC stepped in and took over. And on August 14th of 2009, a purchase assumption agreement was executed between the FDIC and Branch Banking and Trust Company, purporting to transfer certain Colonial Bank assets to BB&T.
But wasn't there a loan sharing agreement that was incorporated into the to that agreement that mentioned the three loans here at issue?
There was a loss sharing agreement that was included within the purchase assumption agreement. That's correct.
Doesn't that give standing to you?
It did not specifically reference any of the loans at issue in this case when it was executed. Subsequent to the execution of that agreement, in fact, I believe it was 2 years later, there was a schedule prepared, Schedule 4.15B, which I'm sure you've seen from the briefings, that was heavily redacted that did identify certain loans that were subject to loss sharing provisions.
Including all three of the loans at issue.
Correct, yes.
Well, isn't that sufficient for standing purposes?
Had that been executed, had that been prepared and attached to the purchase and assumption agreement at the time it was executed, potentially, yes.
Why is it fatal? Because it wasn't.
Because there's no evidence in the record indicating that Schedule 4.15B, even existed when the agreement was signed. To come back 2 years after the fact and prepare a schedule after the lawsuit had been filed and argue that preparation of that schedule creates standing isn't sufficient. There has to be some evidence in the record that there was a transaction that took place that negotiated these instruments from the FDIC to BB&T. And in this case, or in fact, all three of these cases, the record is devoid of any evidence of such a transaction. In fact, speaking specifically with regards to the purchase and assumption agreement, Nevada State Court has already looked at this precise issue. In the Murdoch and the R&S St. Rose Lenders cases we cite in our briefs, specific issue.
It wasn't the same loan that was issued there, and it wasn't a question of the bank standing in that case, was it?
In fact, it was not the same loan.
An evidentiary issue. The schedules had not been presented.
Not quite, Your Honor. It was an evidentiary issue. We have the purchase and assumption agreement. We also had, in October of 2009, a separate bulk assignment that was executed, and then specific assignments as well. In the Murdoch and R&S St. Rose Lenders cases, the purchase and assumption agreement had been produced. That was in evidence. It was that subsequent bulk assignment and a specific assignment that had not been produced that were excluded as sanctions. So the court was looking squarely at the issue of whether or not the purchase and assumption agreement standing alone was sufficient to demonstrate that BB&T had a right to enforce a loan acquired from Colonial Bank through the FDIC. And on that specific issue, looking at the purchase and assumption agreement standing alone, the Nevada District Court and subsequently the Nevada Supreme Court both determined that the purchase and assumption agreement was insufficient to establish that right to enforce those documents. Now, BB&T was a party to that case. It was a case that was adjudicated on its merits, obviously became a final judgment, was affirmed on appeal by the Nevada Supreme Court.
So what issue in your mind was decided in that case that they're stopped from challenging now? What specific issue?
The specific issue is whether or not the purchase and assumption agreement standing alone establishes the right to enforce the loan documents that BB&T acquired from the FDIC. And on that specific point, the Nevada Supreme Court said, no, it does not. Now, granted, the District Court and the Supreme Court in that case, or those cases, was not looking at the bulk assignment agreement or the subsequent specific assignment agreement that had been excluded on evidentiary grounds. what they were looking at specifically was...
Based on a lack of evidence.
Exactly, yes.
Which is not the issue that we have here.
Well, I don't know that there's a meaningful distinction there, because the issue here is does BB&T have standing, and how do they establish they have standing? By establishing that they have a right to enforce the documents at issue. And they've pointed to certain agreements to establish that right, one of which is the purchase and assumption agreement. And it's already been determined by, again, the Nevada District Court and Nevada Supreme Court that purchase and assumption agreement standing alone is insufficient to establish that right.
But they didn't have before the loan sharing agreement or the schedules, correct?
Well, the loan sharing agreement is one of the same with the purchase.
Sorry, loan sharing.
Yeah, it's one of the same with the purchase and assumption agreement. It's the same document. There are numerous schedules that are referenced in that document. However, as we just mentioned, the haphazard nature of the FDIC stepping in and taking over a bank, those schedules that are referenced in the document that should have described what assets were being transferred were never actually prepared or attached to the document. With regard to schedules 3.1 and 3.1A, where those assets should have been identified, to this day, I don't think they exist. Schedule 4.15B, which the court already referenced, that did come into existence later on, but that was 2 years later. I believe it was after the lawsuits had been filed. It was insufficient to retroactively establish standing on that point alone. Once we get past the purchase and assumption agreement, we come to the bulk assignment, which was executed on October 23rd, 2009. That bulk assignment purported to transfer to BB&T all of the security instruments, deeds of trust and related indebtedness that the FDIC had taken from Colonial Bank. Now, that bulk assignment did not identify any particular loan with any level of particularity whatsoever. So on that point alone, we would say that the bulk assignment is invalid. Nevada, like most other states, requires assignments of that nature to be in writing and to describe with some, at least minimal degree of particularity, the interest is being transferred.
If you look at the documents that they refer to, like if you look at the deed of trust, for example, doesn't that identify the problem?
The deed of trust certainly would, but the deed of trust was not specifically referenced in the bulk assignment.
But when you look at the documents, it's just not a single document that's involved here.
No, but again, I think, had there been just a list of deed of trust or recorded documents, reference numbers for someone to go to find those documents, I think that probably would have been sufficient. But again, it did not make any attempt to identify those interests with any degree of particularity. It simply said all security interests, deeds of trust, related indebtedness. I'm paraphrasing, but that's essentially what it said.
If you look at the deed of trust, it describes the property. We know what property we're talking about.
But you don't know it doesn't tell you what deed of trust to look at. In the case of the D.M.S.I. loan, in particular, it's very important because this is an unsecured loan. So that bulk assignment, which purports to transfer security instruments, deeds of trust, related indebtedness, does not apply to an unsecured loan. I believe that was the major error the district court made in this case by not acknowledging the fact that this was an unsecured loan.
Can we jump forward a little bit? Suppose we disagree with you on the standing issue across the board. You had other issues you were raising.
Correct, yes.
Right, so the district judge ultimately entered summary judgment on the question of liability, right?
Correct, yes.
And so, as a result of that, he reserved the issue of damages. He broke that down into two parts. One, he decided that the fair market value of the properties had to be decided. It was an issue that he would decide, not a jury.
Two of the three cases, yes. The DMSI is unique, and that was an unsecured loan.
Right.
So when he granted summary judgment, he didn't enter judgment.
But on the Regina and the other one,
correct.
We're going to go to trial. And he decided the issue of fair market value.
In the Smoke Ranch case, he did, yes, in Regina, because he had determined that the defendants were not entitled to a jury trial on that point. The defendants stipulated with BB&T as to fair market value, reserving the stipulation of their rights.
So what do you understand were the issues that were reserved for trial in the two cases that actually went to trial?
What actually ended up being reserved was simply fair market value. There were also a number of affirmative defenses that the judge later resolved for motion in limine. Said they simply didn't apply anymore, considering that he had already adjudicated the liability issue, which we believe was incorrect.
Now you take issue with this. Is it your contention that some of those issues that he dealt with in the motion in limine, that they actually went to the issue of damages, or that they were never adjudicated in the summary judgment ruling?
Well, they were not. We have to distinguish between the three cases with respect to D.M.S.I. I don't think they were specifically addressed through the ruling on a motion for summary judgment, but through our motion for reconsideration, which was denied, we brought that point up, and the court didn't address it. So I think
what specific issue?
The affirmative defenses of good faith and fair dealing, and estoppel specifically with regard to the D.M.S.I. case, and that was based upon what's been termed a workout agreement, which was.
But those are defenses that went to liability, right?
They did. I believe they also, in the other cases, it's different. DMSI, I think they do address liability primarily, yes, but I think there were questions of fact there that were not.
What about the smoke ranch?
Smoke ranch, we have affirmative defenses that include failure to mitigate, good faith and fair dealing, estoppel, latches. This is a situation where BB&T entered the picture in 2009. Initially gave the defendants the impression they were going to continue working with them as Colonial Bank had in the past, extending these loans. The defendants relied upon those representations, continued paying taxes on these properties, continued maintaining
them. You claim this was a separate agreement. What was the consideration for this separate contract that you allege with regard to the workout? There was no consideration.
The consideration was the defendants continued paying taxes on the properties, continued maintaining them.
Well, you had to do that under the terms of the loan if the property wasn't foreclosed on yet, correct?
They would have had.
That you had to do under the terms of the agreement. That wasn't something that came into being as a result of the workout agreement, correct?
Paying taxes, yes. Maintenance responsibilities, I think, are different. The defendants continued trying to develop several of these properties. They continued working with investors, continued working with architects that had plans drawn up.
Where do you find a duty to foreclose at any given time in the agreement? Where does that come from?
I don't think that's set forth expressly in any of the loan documents.
I'm sorry.
I do not believe that that is expressly set forth in any of the loan documents.
But if you don't have a duty to do something, how do you have a duty to mitigate?
But in about a law, a party seeking relief in the courts or claims have been harmed does have a duty to mitigate their damages. I think that applies virtually across the board.
So when should they have foreclosed on the property then?
Believe it or not, had they foreclosed in 2009, and to put this into context, you have to understand what was happening in the real estate market in Southern Nevada and in Arizona at that point in time. Property values were declining rapidly, and as BB&T delayed the foreclosure, the property continued to decline in value. The deficiency, conversely, went up, all the while BB&T is receiving money from the FDIC into the loss share agreement.
Did your clients have any ability to direct that the property be sold or to request that the property be sold?
They certainly could have put it up for sale. In 2009, there was equity in the properties, in some of them at least. Had, if not for BB&T's representations, that they would continue working with the defendants to find a solution, they likely would have done that with regard to at least a few of the properties. They chose not to because BB&T, again, represented to them that they would continue working with them as Colonial Bank had in the past.
If your theory is supported by case law or something, it would work the other way too, right? In other words, the borrower could make the lender delay because the market's going up. There's no reason why it shouldn't work both ways, is there?
Well,
it's a very open-ended principle, I think you're arguing for.
Well, I don't think it's controversial that a party has a duty to act in good faith, to deal fairly with another party to a contract.
But you're saying, you can, I don't know what control, but you have a strong voice in the foreclosures to take place. That's your case, right? And the lender's got to look at market condition.
Well, the lender ultimately controls when the foreclosure takes place. Like, granted, there are things a borrower can do to delay foreclosure, file bankruptcy. There are certain things that can happen that didn't happen in this case.
Well, why can't you make the case that, they should have delayed for 2 years before they foreclosed because everybody knew the market was going up? It's the same principle, isn't it?
It's similar, but it goes to good faith, I think. That's the main issue.
Exactly. It goes to good faith. You can go, make the good faith argument either way, up market or down market.
I potentially, yes, but in this case, I think what was the focus of the defendant's affirmative defenses and counterclaims in some of the other cases was that BB&T did not act in good faith. BB&T strung them along, convinced them to spend money maintaining these properties, trying to develop them, when BB&T had no real intention of doing any sort of workout agreement with them.
Now, that's an affirmative defense, right?
It was.
In a sense, I mean, it's based on the lender acting in bad faith.
Correct. In the D.M.S.I. case.
You have the burden of proving, right?
Correct, yes.
Okay, now, does that go to liability or damages or both? That bad faith action, assuming it is a bad faith action.
I think you could touch upon both. Because by delaying the foreclosure, the damages sought in the cases which where there was real property collateral increase, those deficiencies went from virtually nothing in 2009 to, I think, we're now at over $20 million.
You raised that in the trial court. Did you get any reaction from the district judge on that defense? Or did he just completely sweep it under the rug?
It varied. In the DMSI case, it was just swept under the rug. We presented evidence in connection with our motion for summary judgment and our opposition to the plaintiff's motion for summary judgment, a declaration of one of the principals, one of the defendants, attesting to the facts underlying this loan workout agreement. In the other two cases, it was
in the SMI case, how were they prejudiced by a workout agreement? There's no property in that case, right?
The agreement was that if the defendants continued to maintain and develop the other properties, that the DMSI loan would be forgiven when the other properties were sold. That was what Ronnie Schwartz, the witness that presented the declaration in support of defendant's motion for Jeff's summary judgment, the opposition to plaintiff's motion for summary judgment testified to.
Now, this workout agreement was just negotiations, right? There was nothing had ever been.
It was not reduced to writing.
It was reduced to writing.
That's correct. It was not reduced to writing.
These are sort of proposals that they were.
I would say it went beyond simply proposals and negotiations. My clients relied on that. They believed the representations were made to them that it would work with them going forward. Granted, it was never reduced to writing, but my clients were comfortable with the relationship as it progressed at that point in time. It wasn't until 2011 when BBT began foreclosing the properties.
Turning to the other two properties, the other two cases that Regina and the other one spoke.
Smoke ranches.
Did the district court actually rule as a matter of law that this mitigation defense to damages was just barred? I mean, it's just not, couldn't raise it as a matter of law.
I don't think it did explicitly, no. It granted BBT's motion for summary judgment, essentially ignoring those issues at that point in time. And when they came up later before trial on a motion in limine, the judge essentially said, I've already addressed this, and didn't go any further than that.
But that was, I thought he was responding to the workout, evidence relating to the workout.
That's correct, yes.
I'm just curious, did he ever say you can't present any evidence regarding mitigation?
Before those two cases had gone to trial, yes. I mean, on the motion in limine, he did say that. Evidence had previously been presented in connection with the motion for summary judgment. I've got a little less than 2 minutes remaining. I'd like to reserve that for rebuttal.
Good morning. May it please the court. Jared York on behalf of appellee plaintiffs, Branch Bank and Trust Company. If I may, I'd like to start, by addressing the constitutionality of the statutory amendment to Chapter 40.459(1)(c). Prior to the amendment in 2011, that statute consisted of a mathematical formula determining the amount of deficiency to be calculated. And that mathematical formula consisted of looking at the indebtedness and seeing how much it exceeded the greater of the fair market value of the property on the date of foreclosure or the amount that was actually paid on the date of foreclosure at the trustee sale. The amendment changed that formula, and it changed that formula such that one no longer looked at the amount of the indebtedness, but in cases in which a party was not the original lender, but rather acquired the loan documents by assignment, the analysis was to look at the amount of consideration that was paid by that party and to see whether or not it exceeds the greater of the fair market value or the amount paid at the trustee sale. And this change was dramatic. Prior to the amendment to 40.459(1)(c), amount of consideration paid between the parties, there was no lender and any subsequent assignee of the loan documents, it didn't matter. The consideration was a matter of dispute between those two parties and those two parties only, and the consideration could have consisted of a dollar or a promise to pay a dollar. Suddenly, in June 2011, the statute was amended so that the amount of consideration paid and the sufficiency of consideration wasn't just an issue for the two parties to the assignment transaction, but rather it became an issue to be raised by the borrower as well.
It's your position that this is preempted, correct?
It is our position, Your Honor, that it is both preempted and invalid by virtue of the contracts.
If we adopt your argument that it's preemptive, it's no necessity to go to the contracts.
You are absolutely correct, and I think preemption is a more thorough analysis because under the supremacy clause, the issue is whether or not FIREA conflicts with the state law, and it absolutely conflicts with state law. FIREA empowers the FDIC with the ability to take the assets of a failed bank and either liquidate them or transfer them to a healthy bank. And courts have, throughout the nation, found that it is an important right to be able to transfer the assets of a failed bank to a healthy bank because that allows the public to keep confidence in the banking industry. It saves money for the FDIC. It's generally good to the public. By limiting the amount of any deficiency judgment to effectively zero, because in most cases, the consideration paid, certainly when viewed retroactively, the consideration paid rarely approaches the fair market value.
So your theory is not that it conflicts with a specific provision, but with the policy behind the federal statute, correct?
I think both, Your Honor, because true, it's a specific policy. It is the policy that allows the FDIC to conduct its business. But I think one can look to 12 U.S.C. 1821, sub D, sub 2, sub G, which are the statutory provisions that allow the FDIC to transfer the assets of a failed bank. And I think that the amended 40.4591C absolutely conflicts with those provisions because it effectively prevents.
Nobody will buy it. You can't transfer it.
The most you could ever make is the most you pay, and no one's ever going to buy those assets. You're absolutely correct, Your Honor. And it absolutely destroys, in the word of one court, destroys the FDIC's ability to do its job. And for that reason, FIREA does preempt the state law. Now, interestingly, the state law was really only on the Nevada books for 4 years. Two legislative sessions went through, and it was finally amended to more tailor to the original purpose of 40.4591C, which was to protect individual homeowners. Interestingly, during the 4 years that the statute existed, it was never applied by individual homeowners. Individual homeowners never utilized the statute. It was utilized in every instance in cases where the FDIC acquired the assets, and in every instance by a large commercial developer of either real property or commercial property. And for that additional reason, it violates the contracts clause.
More importantly, how do you have standing, Howard? Did you have standing to bring this action to begin with?
Well, the appellants raised essentially two arguments regarding standing. One is the Murdoch case, also known as the Rad case or the St. Rose case. And second has to do with questioning the viability of the bulk assignment. As far as the Murdoch case.
SMI loan transferred under the bulk assignment?
It was not a secured loan. However, the bulk assignment, it states that everything that was owned by Colonial Bank in the state of Nevada has been transferred to BB&T. That's what the bulk assignment says, and it was recorded. Now, the fact that the D.M.S.I. loan is an unsecured loan, and therefore there's nothing off record, it certainly eliminates any argument on behalf of appellants that there was something wrong with the bulk assignment because it doesn't concern any real property. But I think it still affects the transfer. The bulk assignment affects the transfer. The purchase and assumption agreement, when combined with Schedule 4.15B.
What is that schedule act?
Schedule 4.15B, what happened was on August 14, 2009, two important transactions took place. One, the FDIC acquired all the assets of Colonial Bank, and on that very same day, BB&T came in and acquired all those assets. It all happened on the same day. And transaction is extraordinarily limited. They get a day or two heads up that the transaction may take place, and then the FDIC accepts a bid.
Was that schedule not developed until after the lawsuit was brought, or was it in place before the lawsuit?
4.15b, because all of the lawsuits were filed in 2011, D.M.S.I. was filed in November 2011. Smoke Ranch was filed actually in March of 2012, and the Regina Holmes one was also filed in March of 2012. It's my understanding that based on the testimony of Brent Hicks, who was the individual at BB2 who worked at the FDIC in preparing the schedule 4.15b, that it existed prior to the filing of the complaint.
And what is the evidentiary basis for that?
The testimony of Brent Hicks. Now,
but it was prepared after the initial transfer.
Absolutely. It was prepared after August 14, 2009, because, again, the parties didn't really know what they were getting. And the FDIC prepared Schedule 4.15B after it had an opportunity to kind of audit all of the loans that were being acquired by BB&T of the Colonial Bank assets. And then it sent them to BB&T and said, here's what you're getting, and here's what the book value is of all of those loans. So it is part of the purchase and assumption agreement, but it was not prepared on August 14, 2009. But it is effective August 14, 2009, because that is when the transaction took place, and the dollar amount that's listed in Schedule 4.15B as to the book value of all the three loans that are the subject matter of this lawsuit, the effective date of that dollar amount is August 14, 2009, because that's when the transaction took place.
Let me ask you a question. This is just an aside, but in this kind of transfer of the assets of a failed bank, that would happen here, in your clients, the purchaser in that transaction with the FDIC, right?
Yes.
Does the agreement include some kind of a whole arm whistle warranties or anything like that?
Well, it does by virtue of the loss share agreement. And the loss share agreement was basically the last half of the purchase and assumption agreement. And in the loss share agreement, the FDIC is saying, here are the assets of this bank, and you're taking them. However, if you should suffer any losses in trying to collect on these assets, we, the FDIC, will initially share in 80% of those losses. So it's a way to tell a healthy bank.
Well, I guess what I'm getting at is, I mean, suppose we conclude that after the fact executed documents are no good or don't serve any purpose at all, your client doesn't have standing. Could you go back against the FDIC because you know they messed up the transaction?
Well, it's an interesting question. I don't know, but the purchase and assumption agreement does say that the FDIC, as the receiver for Colonial Bank, is transferring these assets to BB&T. And if it turns out that BB&T actually didn't get those assets, then certainly they're. The FDIC would not be in compliance with the purchase and assumption agreement. But I guess to complete the thought on standing, there was the question in the Murdoch case, and the Murdoch case is just a different case. Collateral estoppel and issue preclusion does not apply. And there's even some question in the Murdoch case whether it's a standing case or an evidentiary sanction case, because what happened was the only thing that was produced in discovery in that case was the purchase and assumption agreement without the schedules and without the testimony of Mr. Hicks and without the bulk assignment. And so Judge Gonzalez at the district court level in Nevada determined that, and BB&T, after the close of discovery, tried to offer that evidence to show that specific loan had indeed been transferred. Judge Gonzalez says, I'm not going to allow that evidence, therefore you don't have standing. Now, Judge Gonzalez, again, at the state of Nevada district court level, took great pains to say, this is not a standing case, this is an evidentiary sanction case. On appeal, it seems like the Nevada Supreme Court interprets it as a standing case. Regardless, however, the facts are entirely different. In fact, some courts after the Murdoch case have observed that BB&T has apparently learned its lesson from the evidentiary shortfalls in that case, because now when BB&T is attempting to enforce its loans, it does include not only the purchase and assumption agreement, but also, as in these three cases, Schedule 4.15b, the book assignment, the specific assignment, and indeed the testimony of Mr. Hicks or some other employee at BBT to testify as to all of those documents. Bottom line, though, is that I don't think there's any question that BBT had standing either as a holder vis-a-vis the allonge or as a non-holder.
The allonge, you mentioned that it was undated and didn't it have to be attached to the document?
That is true.
And but, it wasn't?
Well, sometimes it was, sometimes it wasn't. When the document was produced, all we needed was a stapler or a paper clip, Your Honor.
But if you didn't have it, you didn't have it.
Well, in some cases it was produced attached, and in other cases it was produced separately. But I think it's a matter of putting form over substance, Your Honor, because there was no question that the borrowers knew that BB&T had acquired the loan. And the reason I know that is because Ronnie Schwartz, one of the borrowers, testified in an affidavit that he had been negotiating with BB&T representatives since August 2009 about this alleged workout agreement, and that these negotiations continued on through the end of 2010. Well, clearly, if the purpose of the endorsement is to put the borrower on notice of who has the right to enforce the loan documents, I would argue that that purpose has been met because the borrower was well aware that BB&T was the holder of that note. But even if we were without a stapler and without a paperclip, BB&T is a non-holder because the loan documents were indeed transferred. There's no question that BB&T possessed the loan documents. There's no question, excuse me, about the purchase and assumption agreement, Schedule 4.15B, and there's no question about the bulk assignment.
Could you turn to the purported defenses and mitigation?
Yes. Yes, Your Honor. Let me first start by observing two kind of inherent conflicts in the appellant's argument. The first conflict has to do with the conflict between saying that BB&T should have foreclosed immediately because property values were decreasing, in conflict with their argument that they were asking for more time to be able to work out their loan. Well, which is, should BB&T have foreclosed and ignored these requests for more time, or should BB&T have not foreclosed and allowed them more time? That's the first conflict. The second conflict
is like a factual matter.
It does, and we don't really need to get to it. And just quickly, the other conflict is that they claim to understand that there was a workout agreement, and yet they signed a written acknowledgement, acknowledging that there has been a modification. They signed in August of 2010 an acknowledgement on behalf of all three of these loans, stating that they understand they've been in discussions with BB&T about potential workouts and potential solutions. However, they further understand that BB&T has not waived any of its rights under the written loan agreement.
Including the right to foreclose.
Including the right to foreclose, absolutely. So, if we're getting to the merits of the workout agreement and the merits of this alleged oral promise, we've got a couple of problems. First, it violates the provisions of the loan agreement. There was no, that the loan agreements require any modifications to be in writing. Second, it violates Nevada's statute of frauds, which also requires a writing, at least as it relates to, well, as it relates to all three loans, because the claim to work out was supposed to be spread out over more than 1 year. And despite that, though, these issues were raised and adjudicated in the context of the motions for summary judgment on liability. They were raised by defendants, and they were denied by the court in all three instances.
The court didn't say much about them.
Maybe the court didn't think much about them, Your Honor, but they were nevertheless raised, and they were denied.
Yes, so this argument about mitigation, is that distinct from the workout agreement? Because it is a legal matter.
Well, I don't think so, because they have to share the same foundation. The foundation being that...
Could the court say, as a matter of law, you cannot raise any kind of mitigation claim at the trial on damages?
I think in this case, Your Honor, the court did hold that, but after considering the merits of the argument and determining that there just was not any merit to the claim.
So that there's no factual basis that would support any claim for mitigation.
Even if we accepted
that, that doesn't come through, does it? Anything in writing, or anything that the district judge said?
I'm sorry?
I say the
Well, I think I reached that conclusion, Your Honor, based on the fact that the issues were raised in the cross motions for summary judgment and denied. And the only
so does that mean because they're denied, that denial as a matter of law means that the district judge considered all the issues that were raised?
I know that's the case in at least one of these matters, Your Honor, because it was raised later on the eve of trial. The defendant said, we have these defenses that we'd like to raise. And the answer was, I have resolved all issues regarding liability and damages except for these three discrete matters, which was the amount of the indebtedness, the amount of the trustee sale, and the fair market value of the property. So I think by implication.
Well, so if we take it as it's being resolved, not being mentioned, how do we decide when it's raised, whether it was error, need to deny it?
Well, again, Your Honor, I think it was addressed in at least one of the cases. The court said, I've considered it and denied it.
That was in the smoke
ranch, right?
Yes, yes.
In the other two cases, they were absolutely the subject of the cross motions for summary judgment and not considered. I think a fair conclusion can be reached that the court considered the arguments and rejected them. And I think there's ample reason to reject them. They're not supported by the law at all. Even if we take the allegations at face value and construe them in the light most favorable.
Well, I mean, maybe, you know, you may have a good argument there with respect to sort of like the implied in fact or estoppel or whatnot. But I'm trying to figure out this idea of mitigation that he's raised. Whether that was a matter of law that's just not a viable approach in this case, or that if you look at the facts that could possibly be presented, they don't support a finding of mitigation.
Well, I think
failure to mitigate.
I think you have both, Your Honor. I think factually you have the testimony of the appellants saying that we were asking for more time. We were asking you not to foreclose, and we were asking for more time to try to work this out ourselves, either to get refinancing or to sell the property ourselves. That's the factual element. The legal element is you've got the case law that we cite in our briefs that says we have the obligation to foreclose at any particular time. BB&T.
Under the contract.
Under the contract.
Therefore, you have no duty to mitigate as a matter of law.
As it relates to the timing of foreclosure, yes, that is correct. Because
and that's the only basis for their claim of mitigation, is that right?
That's absolutely correct.
No other.
No, there are no other. It has to do with the timing of foreclosure, and it has to do with, apparently, they're assuming that BB&T knows where the market is going, which would have been great, but I don't think that was the case, and that BB&T took some action to delay because they knew that the market was continuing to decline. I think Your Honor raises a very good point that the flip side is similarly illogical, that if the market's going up, are we supposed to wait? It just does not make sense.
I think I understand.
Thank you very much, Your Honor. I'll submit the matter for consideration.
There's some time for rebuttal. 2 minutes.
I heard, before I forget about reply to sort of the last comment Mr. North made, that the timing of the foreclosure is the only basis for your defense of the mitigation of damages. Is that correct?
It's based primarily on the timing of the foreclosure, but there's more nuance to it than Mr. North suggests.
Well, so if we conclude, and I don't know what the answer is, but if we conclude that the mortgage holder has no duty to delay foreclosure, does that mean you automatically lose on your mitigation of damages argument? Or you have another basis?
Well, if the court concludes that in this case there was no duty to foreclose at any particular point in time, we probably do lose that argument. But as I said before, there's more to it than that, because in this situation, it's not simply a bank and a borrower working out a foreclosure. It's BB&T taking rights from the FDIC. There's also a loss share agreement under which BB&T is taking payment from the FDIC periodically as time goes on and the property's declining in value, all the while telling the borrowers and guarantors it's going to work with them. That was the essence of the bad faith claim. Just a couple quick points I want to make before I'm out of time. Mr. Nork referenced Ronnie Schwartz as a borrower. He He's, in fact, not a borrower. He's a principal of D.M.S.I., but he's not a guarantor. He's not liable for any of these loans. It was his testimony that the defendants relied on primarily at the trial court level. And second, with regard to Schedule 4.15B, at page 570 of the record, Mr. Hicks, BB&T's witness, testified it had been more, at least 2 years after the purchase assumption agreement was executed as Schedule 4.15B was prepared. And I see that I'm out of time.
Okay. Thank you, counsel. We thank both counsel for their arguments. This morning, very helpful. The matter is submitted.